So it's my pleasure to introduce our
This conference will now be recorded.
is an application engineer at Sri Rapid Technologies Mumbai. For the last 1.5 year, he obtained undergraduate degree in mechanical engineering from Visvesvaraya Technological University, Karnataka, and master's degree in advanced metallurgy from University of Sheffield, UK. He had been working as a research assistant at the Metal Additive Manufacturing Center, Mercury Center, that is at University of Sheffield, before joining Sri Rapid Technologies. He has been working in the field of metal additive manufacturing for the past 3 years, and he also worked on Renisha Orcam EBM and now on 3D Systems DMP printers. Sri Rapid Technologies is the largest reseller of 3D printing in India and has been instrumental in taking 3D printing technologies in India. So they have a broad range of customers in different sectors such as jewelry, aerospace, dental, healthcare, research institutions, and universities, which includes NIT Warangal is also part of it. So now I would like to invite Mr. Lokesh. So Mr. Lokesh, can
yes,
you share
sir.
Your screen? Can you screen your
screen? Yes. Yes, sir, I'll share my screen.
Please, please go ahead. Yeah.
Is my screen visible, sir? So is my screen visible? Can
No, sir. Not yet.
Just give me a minute.
Now, yes, sir.
Now, yes. Okay, sir. Thank you for the introduction, and I would like to thank everyone for showing your interest on 3D printing. So, myself, Lokesh, an application engineer from Sri Rapid Technology. So, I basically deal with metal additive manufacturing as an application and material science engineer. So first of all, I would like to give a brief introduction of what is or what are the different types of metal additive manufacturing. So probably as you are aware, there are four types of metal additive manufacturing in the market as of now. One is the powder bed fusion, next is the direct energy deposition technology, the next one is binder jet, and the fourth one is the atomic bond additive manufacturing, which is also called FDM. So FDM in plastic is called as FDM. In metal, it is termed as ADAM. So that is done by Mark Forged. So these are the four technology that exist today in the market. So in this session, we'll be mainly discussing on powder bed fusion, and on that, especially on SLM. So there are two technologies in metal for powder bed fusion. One is SLM, that is selective laser melting, and the other is EBM, electron beam melting. So the only difference is the energy source that they use. In case of SLM, they use laser. In case of EBM, they use electron beam. So normally it is confusing that the name SLM, because different company uses different terms for naming this technology. For example, Renisha and SLM, they call it as SLM. EOS, they call it as DMLM, direct metal laser melting. And 3D system call it as DMP. So it is direct melting, direct metal printing. The name might be different, but the overall process is the same. So when we get to 3D expert, so 3D expert is mainly used for DMP or SLM or DMLM. that is for selective laser melting. So this is the workflow that goes into the metal, the SLM technology. So first, the process starts from design itself. Earlier, parts were designed for conventional manufacturing, and then it was made by different processes. But when it comes to additive manufacturing, the technology doesn't start in printing, but it starts way ahead of it. So that is in designing. So there are some design guidelines in order to print a part. You can also print a part that is conventionally manufactured, but in order to use the full capability of additive manufacturing, you can start it from design itself. And next is file preparation, where you work with the software, you prepare the file for printing. And then it goes for printing. Once the printing is done, then we remove the powder and then heat treatment. Heat treatment can be stress relieving or annealing process or any other heat treatment processes. And then it goes for support removal and wire heating, where we remove the parts from the plate. And then the final product, where you do some fine machining to get the finished product. So this is the basic workflow of metal additive manufacturing. And now coming into the topic, 3D expert. So earlier it was like design they used to do in a single software. Then again, they have a 3D printing software, example Magix or any other software. In plastic, they have different softwares where you just use the software just for preparation, where you orient it and support it. But when it comes to 3D expert, what 3D system did was they wanted to have a complete solution for metal additive manufacturing. So they wanted to find out a software that can help the customer in all the aspects of the technology, right from designing until the post-processing. So right from scratch to the end product, you can use a single software for metal additive manufacturing. So these are divided into 9 different modules. So I'll try to cover the most important modules available in the software. So the first and foremost thing in preparation or in order to get a successful part are two things, two factors. One is, how do you orient the part? How do you position the part in the tray? Which is the optimum position or which is the optimum orientation? And then the next thing is supporting. How strong you support it? Do you support it in the required place or you just had supports here and there? So these are the two main factors that affects your printing. So this will tell, depending on your position and support generation, you can tell that your part will fail during printing or not, or will your part will deform during printing or not. Okay, so now let me take you to the software and show you how to do this. What are the options available for orientation and support generation? So this is the overall software. So before importing part, normally we decide which printer we are working with. So for example, these are 3D system printers. So this is the one that NIT Warangal has. So this is the one for production that is in our facility in Mumbai. And you select the material, which material you want to work with. So in this case, I'll go for SS316. And if you see this, you have a minimum orang angle as 55. I'll tell you what is that orang angle now. so I add a component. The biggest advantage in 3D Expert is, if you see any software in the market, either for plastic or for metal, every software can read only STL file. So STL file is the extension that is used for 3D printing, that is accepted by 3D printed software until now, because this STL was found out by 3D system. So they needed a software where they get information of the part. So they invented a STL file, which is basically a mesh file. So normally what they used to do is, they used to design a part in a different software, SolidWorks, CATIA, anything, and they convert the file into CAD file into STL, and then they used to import it into the software. But with 3D Expert, you can directly import a CAD file. So this is particularly useful for people who are doing optimizing their designs, where they can go on forth between two softwares. So you don't have to convert the file. You can directly use the CAD file to import it. So the file that I have just imported is a CAD file. So if you see, this is a CAD file. This is not an STL, this is not a mesh file. It's a native CAD file. So once I imported the part, then comes the orientation. One of the most important thing where your final part actually depends on. So in this, earlier I showed you the minimum orang angle was 55. That means what will happen is these regions, if you see the color coding, red region means orang angle, it is 55. I can change it to 45 as well, depending on the material. Automatically the red region will change. And this is up facing. The most important thing and the point of concern is the orang angle, because that is where we support, we generate support. So this is the color coding. So if you are a newcomer, if you don't have an idea like what is the optimum orientation for printing this. So in this software, you have an auto orientation. So in auto orientation, what it basically does, it gives the user an idea like what is my main constraint. Okay, so whether I need minimum supports, if you see in this option, so you have six different options. So one is best fit. So this is like it takes everything into consideration and gives an optimum orientation. Next is time. In 3D printing, if you want to have minimum time, then you have to have minimum Z height. So if you click time, it will show the minimum height possible. Next is the tray area. So this will occupy minimum tray area. So in case if you are if you want to print multiple parts or multiple parts of multiple copies of the same part, so it gives you a minimum tray area. So this is minimum support. So compared to earlier things, if you see, the red region in this orientation is minimum. So this will consider the minimum support. And next is internal support. So in this case, if you see, there are some internal channels in this. So normally you don't want to have supports inside the channels because it's difficult to remove. And if you see, if it is a straight hole, then it is possible to remove. But something like this, it's difficult to remove it, also machine it. So this will give you a best orientation where it doesn't have supports inside. For example, if you see in this, so this is the minimum support orientation. As you can see inside, there are red regions. So if you see here, you have red regions here. It means it requires support at that particular place. So the auto orientation gives you a basic idea. It doesn't tell you whether it is the best option or it is the best orientation, but it will just give you an idea that what can be the initial orientation. This is one option, and you also have option for auto placement, where you can just click some values in order to rotate the part, position it, or you can also do it manually. So you can also rotate the part manually, you can move it, you can orient it. So you can also give the Z. In this case, I'll give 3 mm as Z. So that is nothing but the height of the part from the tray. So you also have option in case if you want to place a flat surface parallel to the plate. So I click on that. And it gets parallel to the plate. And then I give 3 mm height. So I'll take this as a orientation. So now this is my orientation. So I can have a different, it's not that there is just one orientation for a particular part. So it will change from part to part. A part can have two or three, or in case if it's a complex part, or if you have designed it for additive manufacturing, then it will have just one orientation. Once you are done with orientation, the second important thing for 3D printing is support generation. So again, if you see in this, the overhang angle is 55. You can change it anytime. And now what it has basically done is it has created regions where the surface are below 55. Okay, so and you have to decide what type of support I can add, what type of support will be suitable for this particular region. So normally for flat surface, anything close to the plate, we give a solid support. So if you see in this window, you have different types of supports: wall supports, solid supports, lattice, solid wall, cone supports. So you can also have your own supports. So these are the templates actually for different types of supports. You can always create your own type. For example, you have a cone support and you have a particular dimension for it, and you want to save it as a template, you can save it and then use it for your successive builds. So I'll generate support one by one quickly. So this is the solid support basically. And you have a window here. So fragmentation is where you have fragments in between the solid support. Either you can have fragmentation or not. And you have skirting option. Normally skirting is given so that your part holds firmly to the plate. So I'll give this as 1 mm. So this is one kind of support. So I'll quickly generate other supports. We'll have fragmentation for this. The reason why we are having fragmentation is in order to minimize the amount of material that get wasted on support. So if you have a solid support, you're losing a lot of material, but we can't compromise on the part or a build as well. We make sure that we have a firm support, as well as we make sure that it has minimum amount of support going in it. So once this is this region. So in order to add solid wall support, we need to add a pattern. So what type of pattern I want to add? So we have different options where you can have, you know, you can always change the values. I have added this pattern. I also can add boundary fragmentation for easy removal of the support. So now you have the pattern and I go for wall support. So if you see, you can see the different type, different wall support you have. So also in this, you have different designs or shapes for powder removal or saving powder. Because normally after printing, we try to remove as much as material we can. Because in case if you're working with titanium, so which is a relatively an expensive material compared to SS, so you don't want to lose a lot of material on supporting or even, you know, as a waste. So we make sure that we remove most of the material possible. Also, you can change these parameters. So now you have a wall support. So here I'll have a, I can have a solid support as well. So you can always change the spacing or dimension. So this is the diameter. So as I told you earlier, you can change the diameter. And if you want to use this same diameter for successive builds, you can always save it as a template and then work on it. So in case if I want to have the same support here, I don't have to, you know, go all the way from the first. What I can do is I'll click this, highlight this, then I go to template by reference, and then I, in just one click, you have the support. But if you see in this, you have different colors. This is kind of dark pinkish and this is red in color. The reason why it is red in color is because, so if you see here, so you have supports that is coming in contact with the part. So if you can finish it, then you can leave it as it is, or you can always go and tilt it. So what I'm doing is I'm moving the supports away from that part. I can also scale this. So if you see in this case now, the support is not coming in contact with the part. So I'm happy with it. And I can start the same thing for this. So this can have a different option as well. So say in case if I want a solid at the bottom, so I can give solid. So in this case, you have a solid bottom so that it is firmly placed on the tray. So you can give the distance. So in this case, I'll give it from the tray. So this is how you orient and generate supports for the part. We quickly generate support for this. So in this case, if you see it's coming in contact with the surface I can always tilt it. Now it's good. I can change the spacing. So this is how you normally orient and generate the support. So these are the main important factors that will affect your print. So in case if you don't have these supports properly, or in case if you have a different type of support at a particular place, then your build might fail. So this is the two key factors that normally affects your printing. So any questions on this?
So anybody's having a quick questions, specific question, one or two? Hello.
Sir, what are the material you have selected for supporting, sir?
Sorry, sir.
Material. What are the material you have selected, sir, for supporting?
So in Powerbed Fusion, the support material and part material is the same, because in machine you can just put one material. It can be either whatever material. In this case, so even the
hello. So you don't switch on your microphones. Hello. Only one can ask. Hello. Hello, Mr. Lokesh.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. Any other questions from the participants? One more question if you have. Otherwise, let him continue.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Sir, good
yes,
afternoon.
Sir.
Yeah, I have a doubt. This is the only way by which we can support this component. Are there any other ways, like we can have some other material which can support it, which is earlier, before this process only have made? Hope you have got it.
Yes,
my doubt
sir,
is,
got...
Why? Because for making these supports also it take time, no sir. So in order to reduce the time, can't we fabricate the support earlier to this process, so that acts as only supporting by some other ways, like casting or by, because detailing is not required for the supports, no sir.
Yes sir, but for casting I don't think you can have these kinds of support. Again, if you're going for casting, you're spending money on that, and then you're wasting material on that, and then you're doing it again. If it is a simple geometry, if it is a flat surface like this, probably you can try. But since powder bed fusion is used for making part from scratch, so it is advisable to use the supports that is present here. I won't say it is not possible, but it is not required.
Acha. If at all we want to do like that, is there any option in this particular software for using?
No sir, not for this actually. So in case no, that is not possible.
Okay Mr. Lokesh, hello.
Yes sir.
Yeah, it's okay. And then there is a one question from the chat box. Hello.
Okay.
Lokesh, are you able
yes,
to hear me?
Yes sir. Yes sir, I can hear you, sir.
Yes. there is a question in the chat box asking, if you use the auto orient option, will it give
the
lowest material consumption? Basically, which criteria it's going to set? Actually, you have a different criterions there. You have showed some six criterions. So which criteria it will fit in a default orientation? Yeah, that is the question.
For lowest material, you always go for support. So because material will be the same no matter what is the orientation.
Okay.
So material that you can if you go for minimum support orientation, then you can save material, or it will add up to, you know, low cost, lowest material consumption.
Okay, Mr. Lokesh, and one last question.
Yes, sir.
What is the basic difference between wall, solid, cone type of supports?
Sir, all the supports are same. The only thing is, if you are having a complete solid part.
Okay.
So when it comes to additive manufacturing, stress plays a major role, because in this technology, you are rapidly heating the material and cooling it. So this comes up with having a high residual stress. Okay, as you're printing the part, so the residual stress keep adding. And if you don't have then your part might warp, or it might deform. So deform, it might be a minimum deformation, or it can even, you know, completely deform and separate from the separate itself from the supports.
Right.
So always the type of supports I add depends on the surface, how much geometry it has on top of it. So if I'm so in this case, the normal deformation will happen probably here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if I'm giving enough supports in this case, so this won't deform. So that my supports will hold the part firmly.
Okay.
The other role of support is, there are two roles of support. One is to hold the part firmly from snapping or from warping. The other thing is to reduce the residual stress on the part. Because normally what happens is, since you're printing layer by layer, so you are hitting this layer, the layer just above the supports, and the heat get transferred to the support and it comes down. So as it is keep on moving, if you are having very minimum support, a much gap in between, then the heat transformation or heat conduction is very less. In that case, there are more residual stress on the part. So when we support it, we keep two things in the mind. One is the residual stress, and the other is the overhang angle, how much overhang angle it has. So in this case, the reason why I gave solid support here is, so you have a complete, almost a big solid part on top of it. In this case, it's just like a few mm. So the height of this is like probably around 24 mm. So it won't deform much. So I'm giving a much lesser support for that. So it always comes with experience. So what kind of supports is suitable for what kind of part?
Okay.
So if I'm, for example, I'm printing a block, a solid block, a rectangle of 20 mm length and 20 mm breadth, and width is 5 mm, which is a thin plate, I'll give a solid support, because due to residual stress, the plate will deform. So I give a solid support, a minimum solid support of 1 mm, and then wire idiom it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Very good. Okay. Okay,
Can you tell on that overhang angle? Can you just repeat on overhang angle?
So overhang angle is the
voice is not clear. Why? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Voice is breaking, your audio.
Just give me a minute, sir. Is it clear now, sir? Hello?
Yes, it is clear, sir.
It is clear, right.
Okay, so when I say Orang angle, so it is the surface that is at an angle with respect to the plate. So if it is completely parallel to the plate, then it is zero. Then as it progresses, so it the angle changes. Let me show you with the color option. So if you see in this, so this is my zero angle because this is completely flat. And if I move here, so you can see the angle changing. So when I come to above 55, so I don't have a red region. So this means the red region has to be supported. So it tells you that, okay, these are the red region, these are the overhang angle, it has to be supported. In case if you don't support it, you're putting the part on the powder. So when you're printing a part on a powder with a high laser power, then there will sag. It won't have a proper surface finish, it will sag because you just have powder plated.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Lokesh, hello.
Yes, sir.
One last question from my side.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Actually, have you heard about Valo? There is a company which making metal 3D printers, Valo, VELO.
No, sir, I'm afraid.
Fine. Then actually, my question is Valo, they are claiming that the overhang is less than 5 degrees. That is what they are claiming. So that's what I'm asking. You're saying it's a 40, 55 or so, but they're claiming 5 degrees only. Even I never come across that, but it is true. There is a Valo company and they're claiming the supports maybe 5 degrees. That's what. Okay, anyway. Okay, continue, Mr. Lokesh.
Okay, yeah. Sir. Okay, sir. So this is about the orientation and support generation. So once you're done with this, how do I know that whether this supporting is enough or whether the support that I've given will result in a successful print? So that's a big question. Earlier, what they were doing was they were just doing it by trial and error. Like you support it with your experience, load it, print it. If it fails, again, you give us a different support, reinforce it, and then again print it. So they were doing a number of iterations on this to get a successful print. But now, in order to make life easier for the user, they came up with build simulation. So they came up with build simulation. So normally build simulation, what it does is it gives you an idea, a real picture of what is going to happen during the build, even before that. So I'm not going to print the part to check whether my supporting or my orientation is proper. What I can do is I can do much earlier than that so that it will reduce the number of iteration that will go into the part because, as I told you, your 3D printing is just not wasting the material, but also you're wasting a lot of resources like your inert gas, electricity. Okay, so in order to save a lot of money and time, so they came up with build simulation. So this basically reduces the number of iterations that goes into building a part. They won't say, this is not like if I simulate it, okay, this will come 100% foolproof. But as I told you, it will reduce the number of build iteration. Earlier, you were doing for 5 iterations, now you are just getting it in 1 or 2 iterations. Okay, so that is one advantage of build simulation. And then to validate your support and lattice design. So I'll go through later, But in case if you're doing some topology optimization, or if you are doing some lattice optimization, in that case, build simulation validate whether the part is, the part will come out successfully or not.
Hello.
And yes, sir.
Hello. Sir, sorry to interrupt you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt you, but I wanted to ask that nowadays in many of the design softwares, itself they give the optimized design and optimized support needed and optimized orientation of the product. Then what is the difference in 3D Expert and those other like GrabCAD and all?
So now most of the companies, yes, what you said was right. One thing is they give you a depending on residual stress, as I told you, depending on residual stress, they'll give an optimum orientation. I don't think they give the optimum orientation, but they give an optimum supports for that particular orientation. I'm not wrong.
Yes, 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 yes.
Because optimum orientation,
because
they
can't. Yes,
yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So orientation is, yes, the user has to do it. But you can simulate it and say, okay, this is the minimum supports that will require for this part, depending on, you know, for the heat generation and residual stress and stuff. Yes, that is possible. But in this, what we are doing is we are not, sir, if you want to buy a software that does that, always cost comes into play. So say for support generation and orientation, if I have a software that cost me around like 50 lakhs or 60 lakhs, and then the rest of the things I need to have a different software. But 3D Expert is like a whole process. Okay, that makes, yes, as you said, that makes your life easier because it will show the minimum supports, where you need, what kind of supports you need, something like that. But still, nothing is foolproof. As I told you, I won't say that if you simulate it and print it, my part will come 100% without failing. It will fail at some time, depending on the geometry or depending on the part. So what we are doing is, in 3D Expert, what they are doing is, they don't want to have a high cost because, you know, small scale or a proprietorship company won't afford to have a software only for that purpose, just for simulation. Yes, we have software only for simulation, but that costs you around 40 to 50 lakhs. And again, you need to have a different software for supporting an orientation. And again, you need to have a different software for other things as well.
Okay, Lokesh. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So we have a very limited time, so then we have to finish everything. So actually, but there is a one interesting question from the chat box. Again, I'm reading. So is this simulation is considered as a multiple physics?
Yes, sir. To be honest, I don't have much idea about it. Multiple physics. So probably I can.
Yes, you know, you got the question, or do you want to be elaborated the question, or you got the question?
Actually, I don't understand the word multiple physics.
Okay, can you, who asked that one? Can you elaborate? Who is that? Ananda Rabi Dar. Hello.
Yeah, actually, sir, I wanted to ask whether some other than mechanical means dynamics, thermodynamics, or means heat radiation, heat convection, all these things which are taught in other areas of physics are taken care by building the simulation part of the software.
Yes, sir. It considers the mechanical as well as the thermal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, sir. So this is about the build simulation, why build simulation is normally used, and I'll I've already generated.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is Srinivas from DMRL.
Yes, sir.
Just one clarity, I need a clarification for this build simulation. Does it mean that we get the temperature profiles at different surfaces while it has the process of build simulation?
In this case, it doesn't show.
What aspect does it look into exactly?
Sorry, sir.
What aspects does this build simulation look into exactly to confirm that the build is going to be successful or not?
Yes. So it will consider the material property, the residual stress, and then the heat deflection and the, you know, heat conduction towards from bar to support. Basically, the main point of interest in this build simulation is where the support and the part meets. Because your part is okay, you have designed it, you have done some analysis, so your part is okay. So it will be built successfully, depending on the geometry.
Okay.
The main point of interest in this build simulation is where your support and part meets. So I'll show you that. So if you see in this, you have different options. One is displacement, one is three-quarter interference, displacement stress. So these are the factors that build simulation addresses you. So I'll hide this. So if I scroll it up, so if you see here, this is the deflection that is happening at that particular region. So this is not constant, it will keep changing.
Okay.
So if you see, this is the place where this is your part and this is your support. So this will show you where does my part might fail. So how much is the deflection?
Okay.
And all those things. So as I keep moving up, so if you see in this region, so if you see there is a small deflection here at the red region in this place.
Yeah, yes, the red zone.
It's like around 0.2 mm. So still that is okay. If you see the other regions, this is okay. You can just move over it, and if you see, okay, deflection is not much. And again, if you see, even here, if you see, there's more deflection compared to other regions. So when I move up, so this is where your first layer of the part get printed. So in this case, if you see, there is some deflection here. So if you see it just like now, so you can see there's a movement of the support. So there is a deflection here. So if deflection fail your part or not, so that so, and in this case, if you see, already your supports have been broken. So if you see, there's a huge deflection here, and in here, if you see, it's like 0.9 mm, so it's almost 1 mm of deflection.
Okay.
So this will tell you, okay, the part will fail here. So the support that I have given at this place is not proper, is improper. Either I can have the same support and increase the thickness, or I can have a different support. So if you see, the reason why I gave you three different supports in this is to show you the difference, like which support will act differently. So this is the cone support, deflection is around 0.6.
Okay.
And this is the lattice support, where the deflection is like almost 1 mm. And if you see this grid support, so it's very minimum deflection.
Yeah.
So in this case, I get to know that, okay, my part will fail here. It gives you a basic idea, okay, this is where my part will fail. or it will crash or it will warp. So what I can do is I can always go back. I can change my supports here. So I can delete this support. I can have the same kind of support in this place as well. So since I know, okay, this support is strong enough for this part, so what I'll do is I'll add the same kind of supports here as well. So then it, I know that, okay, this won't fail here because I have a strong enough support that can hold the part firmly. So this is about deflection. So the next is recoater interference. So normally after every layer you print, you add a layer of powder. As you're adding a layer of powder, your recoater comes in contact. In case if it is comes in contact with the part, what will happen is either the recoater will damage depending on what kind of recoater you are using, or your part will get damaged. In case of solid recoater, as in case of DMP 100 that is in Warangal, so they have a solid support where in case if the recoater comes in contact with the part, it will crash the part, also damage the recoater. In other case, you have a soft recoater, something like a silicon blade or a silicon roller, where it won't damage your part, but it will damage the recoater, the silicon blade. But silicon blade is relatively inexpensive, so it is okay. So this will show, will my part come in contact with my recoater?
Okay. That depends on the deflection, I guess.
Yes, it depends on the deflection. So in case if you have improper supporting for one part for this region, and your part will deflect and warp, so it will come up little bit. In case it comes contact with the roller, then it will crash the build. So again, you have to redo it again. So this shows you the interference. So next is inner and outer displacement. So earlier was the deflection. It never said did the part shrink or did the part expand because of heat. Okay, so this inner and outer displacement will show you. So if you see in this column, so pink shows is like minus 1.17 mm, and the yellow region shows you like 1.4 mm. So this shows how much your part has shrunk or expanded. So in this case, if you see compared to other regions, so you see a little bit of yellow and pink region here. Here it's very, very minimum. But in this case, if you see, you have a surface where it's completely pink and yellow. So it shows a portion of the part has shrunk, a portion of the part has expanded. And you can also verify with your actual model. So let me show you the actual model in this case. So this is my actual model. And see, this is my deformation. So this has come a little bit up. So it means that, okay, my supports are not proper. In this case, if you see here, it has come up a little bit. In this case, it's very, very, it's negligible basically. So this gives you an idea, okay, do I need to support more or not? That is the only thing that you get in this, in simulation, whether my support is proper or not. Will it fail during printing or not?
So again, inquiry.
Yes, sir.
Does it mean that it can also give us the temperature, approximate temperatures at particular locations during the build? Because the whole deflection is based on the thermal conservation.
Yes, sir, but the calculation that they have done, the whole algorithm is based on temperature. But you, in this case, you won't get the temperature reading.
Yeah, they are not given that feature in this software, right?
Yes, they have not given that.
Okay.
So the next is plasticity. How much your part has deformed plastically. So again, this is the region where my part has plastically deformed. So then it gives you a stress in Z, X, Y, and X, Z. So these are the options that you get in build simulation. These are the ideas that you get in build simulation.
Yeah, thank you so much, very detailed, you have elaborated. Thank you.
You can add some finite element analysis like that, it will.
So finite element analysis, in case if you're doing lattice, you will have finite element analysis because I'm doing some design changes. In this case, it's trial and error because as I told you, okay, this is fine. This support is fine. I'll add the same support here. So it makes my, it saves my time. In case if you want to have FEA for this, then again it adds up to your cost. So everything depends on the requirement of the customer or the people they use.
Okay, thank you.
This is about build simulation. So I'll carry on with the next portion. Okay, so once I'm done with this, this is the basic of printing: orientation, support generation, simulation, and then you send the file in the machine and you print it. So this is to get a successful, this is the basic three steps that is used to get a successful printing. So the next option that I'll be going to is an additional option depending on the application. So
sorry sir, actually I wanted to ask, actually I had doubt. Suppose I select a particular region, some support, any type of support, solid cone or lattice or a grid, any support, will that immediately calculate the amount of material used for the support for a particular region?
Yes, not for the particular region, but you'll get an estimate for the whole support actually. For example,
it will be easier if for a particular region the material is then and there calculated and shown. Then I'll also have in mind that this if the support material is used means wisely. Thank you.
Yes, sir. You'll get overall material. So in this case, if you see, so this is my support, this is my part material, and this is my support material. But if you're keeping in your mind that I want to have minimum supports or minimum power material into the support, then you are compromising your build. The first main thing that we normally keep in mind is the we make sure that the build is 100%. It doesn't crash or it doesn't deform. Because in case if you little bit of if you give importance for little bit of material in supports, in case if the part fails, then you are losing a lot of material that goes into the part as well as in the support. Yes, we obviously make sure that we give minimum material for support, but still we don't compromise it on the complete build. So as I told you, we don't get material information for particular region, but you get information for the overall support. Am I clear, sir? Can I move on?
Yeah, please. Thank you.
Yes. So the next topic that I go into is the lattice structure. Basically, lattice structure is mainly used for weight reduction. So the main application of lattice structure is in medical applications and some in aerospace or in some in aerospace or automobile. But mostly, most of the, you know, all the lattice, different types of lattice and all this lattice is mainly applicable for medical application. The reason why they have lattice, they want lattice structure for medical application is one is for weight reduction. The next is for the body tissue to grow into the part. So once you have an implant inside a human body, then it has to act as the body itself. So if you have a smooth surface or if you have a very smooth surface, then the body tissue won't grow properly on it. It will just stick to it, but not it won't be a part of a body. But in, when it comes to lattice, the body tissue starts growing even inside the lattice structure. As it has voids inside, it starts growing inside. So that is the main reason why they are using lattice structures nowadays, especially for medical implants, for either for hip joint or any implants, or in some applications where you use it for lightweighting. So in this case, if you see this, this is a bicycle part where they have used lattice for weight reduction, and the part is made of titanium. So basically, for raising cycles, people who are participating in UK, probably when I was in UK, during the Olympic, all the critical parts of the bicycle was made by 3D printing. The handle was made by 3D printing. You know, the point where this junction, this part was made by 3D printing in titanium. So that gives you a aesthetic look as well as you have titanium for weight reduction. So there are two types of lattice. I'll show you in the software. One is infill lattice. So that goes inside the part. So basically it makes the part hollow. So the other is the surface lattice. So where they use it for other medical application. So these are the types of different types of lattice that are available in 3D Expert. The default ones, actually, these lattice are default ones. And this is a part where you can add lattice at different region. So you can always, you don't have to create lattice for the whole part, but you can create for a particular portion of a part. You can always do that. You can always have a surface lattice. So this part, if you see, this is an jet engine exhaust. So if you see behind a jet engine, you have an exhaust made of inconel 6-5. So earlier this was made from sheet metal. So normally they used to do in sheet metal, form it, and then weld it at the end. But in 3D printing, so you can do it as a single part seamlessly. Okay, so if you see here, this part is very, very thin actually. Because of residual stress, there are chances of deformation. What they did was, they added surface lattice for this part because it's very thin. It's basically a sheet. And they added surface lattice for this, which acts as a support. So this keeps the part from deflecting or from bending. And this is one application of the surface lattice. Not only for medical application, but also it adds as, it was used as a support. So after once printing is done, these supports will be machined off and the part can directly go into a jet engine. So this is the application of lattice. So I'll quickly go into.
One thing. Are the lattices designed in such a way that they don't need supports?
Yes, sir. I'll show you that now. These lattices, because normally if you have supports for lattice, then it is difficult to remove, and you're wasting material on that. And so in case if you have supports for lattice, then it doesn't make sense. So I'll show you that.
This is the reason I'm asking this, because I have seen some softwares where they generate lattice structures, but they don't know whether it can be built without support structures or not. So whether 3D expert has taken into that into consideration?
Yes, sir. I'll show you that practically now. So I'll go to create lattice. So I select this part, and these are the different lattice options available. So there are six default lattice in 3D Expert, but the advantage of having 3D Expert is you can always create your own lattice and have it as a template. So if you see here, so currently we don't have any templates, but you can always save a template. You can always, what you need to do is just create a unit cell, something like this, and save it as a template. Once you save the template, then you can use the lattice for a number of parts. Okay, so I'll just create a simple lattice.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Sir, Lokesh sir, so
yes, sir.
That unit cell, can I import into this software after designing in some other software, like, you know, Perdworks or some other way?
Yes, sir, you can.
Can I import it?
The only thing is you just need to save it as a template. You can either create in the software, you can create in any design software. Because as I told you earlier, this software accepts all CAD files. It's not just STL, so you can always have, you can add any STL, you can design it in any software literally, and you can always save it, open it here, save it as a template, and then you can use it, sir.
Sir, one more thing. So if you, yes. Now you are applied the gyroid stochastic structure right over there. So what about the open structure? You see the cellular structures are open one and closed one. So wherever the open structures are there, how can we close them?
Which open structures, sir? I'm sorry.
This one, sir. Actually, now we have used this gyroid, right?
Yes.
Main body. So
yes.
The cell may not at the edges. The cell may not be fully suit for it. Might be
yes.
In the half portion.
Yes,
so
sir.
How it can be embedded?
You mean at the edge? You mean here, sir? If I'm not wrong. Hello. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Rakesh.
Sir.
You are not responding. Sir. He is asking
Hello.
Something.
So you mean at this
yes,
region?
Sir. Yes, sir. At the edges only. It is clear, sir.
Okay. Normally you can. Yes. Normally you can see. What I'll do is, okay, I'll save this. So this is the complete lattice. Okay. You can always add shell to it. So say my inner is lattice, my outer region, I want to have a shell.
But in that case, and how can I remove the trapped powder then?
Yes, I'll show you that, sir. So this is the shell. I give an offset value from outside. So I give it as 2 mm.
Okay.
Then I have an option called select open faces. Here I have option for select drain hole faces. Either you can have a complete face open.
Uh-huh.
You can just, so this face. So this complete face is open now.
Okay.
Or I can do holes at particular point so okay. that, yes. So there's always scope for powder removal.
All right, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. So let me answer the question that you asked, sir. Oh, sorry. Okay, so this is the lattice. So in case if I change the orientation after a while, so this will position in such a way that you don't have any support, any portion that is like these connectors will be always more than 45 or 55. So if you see the connectors, it clearly shows that, okay, this angle is more than 45. Just by visual, I can say that this is more than 45.
Yeah.
In case if I change my orientation, this will automatically change it. So if you see again, my shape has changed. And if you see these angles, these are like more than 45.
Yeah.
So what it normally does it, it keeps changing the angle depending on the orientation that you give. So what I'll do is make it a little bit clear. I'll give. So now you have this.
Okay.
So if I position it. I click OK. If you observe cleanly, the connectors has changed. So in this software, as you're orienting it, keep on orienting it, it makes sure that your lattice doesn't have support. So connector of the support or no portion of the support will be at an angle where it will require support. So this is a default operation. So you need not worry about will the lattice have supports or not. Yes, sir.
So that means when I'm creating a unit cell, a lattice unit cell, it does not remain the same, I think. Because it will change automatically as per the requirement of the orientation, isn't it?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Like before previously you have shown this, yes, exactly. This what do you say, gyroid structure?
Yes, sir.
Because it's like a circle, so I don't think it is possible to build such a lattice without supports. If at all we want such kind of lattice on the component circuit,
it is possible.
Or else it will change out.
No, it is possible. If you see this, normally once we have done orientation.
Okay.
So because lower surface you will have this one, say a solid face, a shell.
Right.
So once you are done with this, so only at the edge portion or where it starts, it will come in contact with the shell. So once it starts building, okay, now the complete part has started building. So if you see, it will keep joining and the portion is very small. This region is very small. So it won't have any problem in printing.
Which region? I could not get you. Which region is small?
This region. This region. So this is where normally you will need supports. So where it joins. So this is where we need supports normally. Okay. So say I'm printing in 30 microns. So this is where I need supports. This is where I need supports.
Okay.
Okay, if it is a large surface area, or if the distance between these two points is like more than 5 mm, 6 mm, then you need supports there. But in this case, say you won't have a proper finished surface here. Okay, so you'll have a little bit rougher surface compared to other regions.
Okay.
But it doesn't affect the part. Because your finishing doesn't matter in the lattice. So lattice, whether it has a less RA or a more RA, it doesn't matter.
Yes,
so it's only the outer surface. So lattice will hold good. So you won't have any issue printing this part.
Okay.
So say for example, if I'm, yes. So if, as I showed you in this, this part, I guess, this part. So, this part is right in front of you. So this is the guard one, and this didn't need supports. This here, can you see, sir? That's why I have showed this, shared this image, that all the possible lattice structures, and these are without support. Okay. This is without support, nothing is without support. And right in front, this is the surface lattice. So I'll show you the surface lattice in case if you don't have any questions on this.
Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Sir, one question. The supports which have placed at the bottom, whether they are solid or they are hollow?
They're solid, sir.
They're solid. So can we replace those support material by these kind of lattice structures?
You can, because we have lattice supports. You can always do that. Yes.
No. My question is, to the main part, this wing is there, right? There are three wings. To the main wings, that is the main material. At the bottom, when I play, give the supports, no, the vertical supports. Here. Mm-hmm. Yes, those vertical supports, can I make that vertical supports using this lattice structures?
Yes, you can. Yes, sir, you can always make it as a lattice support.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Just make sure whether the lattice support is good enough to hold the part or not. You can literally, yes, the advantage of 3D Expert is you can literally do anything that you want, sir. Everything is possible in this. But the only thing is you need to know what to do and what is right. So you can always do different things in this. So I'll move on to surface lattice. So surface lattice, I click on a particular surface. And even in this, you have different options, like 8 different options. So if you see, this is how you have supports, either for medical implants or as I showed you this example. So this is the same one as these ones. So you can use it as a support. Or also you can use it for medical implants to have a proper tissue growing inside the implants, or this can also be used for heat exchangers where you want a high surface area for optimum heat dissipations. So you can have this surface lattice for that as well. So this is same like the normal infill lattice. So, but it has a different kind of application. And the other option that we have other than lattice is solid infills, where this is much stronger compared to lattice because lattice structures are weaker. So it cannot be used for all the applications or all weight reduction applications. For medical implants, yes, or where, you know, the boundary conditions or the load applied on the particular part is less. In case of infills, it is much stronger than lattice. It gives you a hollow design, but it will be strong enough as well. So this is, it creates solid walls, something like this. So you can always change the pattern. So you can always do FEA for this and change the pattern, stuff like that. You can also have perforations. Let me show you without perforation first. So this is without perforations. So material removal becomes a little bit tricky here. In that case, you can always add perforations. So in case if you had perforation, you can always change the shape or the dimension as well. So if you have perforation, so your material removal becomes easier. Even in this case, as in case of lattice, you can have a shell and the shell can have holes as well. So this is a different option that it has. Once you are done with this, you want to know whether this part, the lattice or the infills that I've created, is strong enough. For that, we have an option, lattice FEA. So you can do FEA analysis for this part. So I can always give the, so I want this region to be fixed. So this is fixed, then I give some boundary load conditions. So load conditions, I can always give. And if you have static analysis here, you have vibrational. In case of vibrational, you have different modes where you can change the frequencies. In vibrational, you have different load conditions, whether it is concentrated load or it's a torque or pressure. And you can always select the material, what material you are working with. So we have a database. So this is our material database. So I can give a different material. So I'll select this. Okay. So this is my yield strength, Young's modulus. And then I can, you want high accuracy or normal accuracy, then I can start my analysis. So this will show whether the supports, the lattice or the infills that you have created will sustain the load condition in real world or in during its application. And with what material working with, in case you do FEA, okay, not proper, again you change the lattice structure or you increase the size of the connector and this, and then you can always do this back. So as someone asked, FEA is there for lattice because you're doing the lattice and infills in 3D export. But you can also add lattice designed in different software. You can have a part, do it, do optimization, and then transport it here, and then you can even do lattice FEA in this region.
Okay, Lokesh, actually we are, yeah, you are giving very good explanation, but sorry to interrupt.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, actually, can you move on to the next phase? Or
yes, sure.
Yeah, thank you.
So lattice is one of the option. Next is the conformal cooling channels. When it comes to mold design, I'll quickly cover this because this is application based. Mainly for making tools for injection molding. So earlier conformal cooling channels were made just by drilling around the pattern. So if they create a mold for a plastic injection molding tool, they want cooling channels around it so that as the part is cooling, because injection molding is taking place at a higher temperature. So as the part is cooling, as the plastic is cooling, they want to make sure that the rate of cooling is even in all the places. So earlier they were doing like this. So what they were doing is they were just drilling holes around the pattern. But in case if it is a complicated pattern, so just by drilling straight holes won't ensure sufficient cooling. In 3D printing, the advantage of having 3D printing is you can print conformal cooling channels in different shapes. So in this case, if you see, you can design cooling channels at equidistance from all regions. So you have a mold, you have a pattern, so you can create cooling channels at an equidistance from the pattern. So if you see this heat deflection or rate of cooling or heat deflection, in this case, you have a higher temperature in this portion. In this case, if you see, the temperature distribution is even at all region. So this is the main application for having conformal cooling. So I'll quickly so how do you do that? So this is the part I've already created. So this is not outside the portion. If you see this thread region, the piping, so this is done well inside the part. It's not outside the part. So this is my actual part. So what I can always do is just keep me a minute. So this is my part. So I have option mold design, and then I have two options. And I have different shapes of cooling channels. I can have a teardrop or something like an X or a circle. Also change the value. So I'll take it as 0.8. And the next radius angle as 5. So now I have created an offset. If you see here, mesh offset on, offset is 1 mm. So I've created an offset of 1 mm from the outer surface. So once I'm done, so I'll hide the main portion. So this is where I want to add this cooling channels. So what I'll do is I'll just keep clicking the corners. So in this case, if you see, you're just adding supports and columns. So this is an example. How do you create? This is the most simplest way you can create cooling channels. So this is how the channels are, and this is well inside the part. Something as I showed you before. Something like this. So if you have cooling channels here. So this is about conformal cooling channels, one of the options available in 3D Expert. This is mainly application based. I don't think it is useful for institutes. And the next and most important thing, and the most important topic that most of the research institutes or universities are interested in, is process parameters. How am I going to change my process parameters if I want to develop new material, or if I want to have a different layer thickness? So when it comes to a part, building a part, there are four main factors, or I would say three main factors, that would affect the density of the part and the quality of the part. So the main thing is, one is the hatch spacing. Hatch spacing is nothing but the distance between two layer tracks. So I'll show you in the software what is hatch spacing, or the distance between the laser tracks, to put it in a simple way. So next is the laser power. So laser power changes with material. For different material, you have a different laser power. And also it differs with height. If I'm printing in 60 microns, I'll have a different laser power. If I print in a 30 micron, I have a different laser power. So laser power always changes. And then the scan speed. So scan speed is one of also the most important factor that will influence, that is how fast your laser is traveling on the platform, how quickly it is moving. So that is nothing but scan speed. So these are the three main factors which is interrelated or interconnected. So you cannot neglect one parameter and concentrate on the other. These are interlinked parameters. So in order to develop a new material, a parameter, process parameter for a different material or altogether new material, you need to address all these three or four parameters. So next is layer thickness. So layer thickness is nothing but you change the hatch spacing, laser power and scan speed depending on the layer thickness. So that is about the layer thickness. So these are the four main parameters in order to develop your own build parameters. So you'll find that in calculate slice. So in this case, you see, this is my part and I have settings. And I open a tab where I have general parameters. So in this case, if you see general tolerance, layer thickness, bricks on the wall. But our main interest is in contour and hatching. So contour is nothing but the outer region of a part. So this outer region is called contour. So contour have a different parameter. So it has a different down facing angle and middle. The most important parameter is the hatching. So that, because that decides the density of the part, how good is the part, how dense the part will be. Okay, In this case, you have hatching parameters. This is rotation angle. Normally, what happens in 3D printing is once you print one layer, the same position, the same orient, the hatching will rotate at certain angle. So that is called the rotating angle. So if you see, this is the start angle. So this is the start angle, and this is the increment angle. So if you see in this portion, so let's look into this. So this is completely parallel, like this is like a box. And if you see here, it has changed its orientation to 45 or to 45 degree. So after every layer gets printed, the laser or the pattern keeps changing. So this pattern depends on this. So I have different patterns. One is stripe, the other is rectangular cell, and the other is hexagonal cell. So you can have any sample or any pattern. You can try it with different pattern, or always you can have a rectangular cell. So for normal thing, either we use strip or rectangle. In case of DMP 100, we are using hexagonal. So as I told you, this hatch spacing. So this is the hatch spacing. So here it is called sidestep. What is my hatch spacing? So this is material dependent. For SS316, I have a hatch spacing of 78 micron. If I go for titanium, I'll have a hatch spacing of 100 microns. If I go for aluminium, I'll have a hatch spacing for 90 microns. So this is the down facing area. And this is the middle facing area where most of the part comes in. So if you see this, the sidestep is different, the hatch spacing is different for this, and even the pattern is different. So this is the start angle, this is the increment angle. So these are the main things that you change or tweak in order to change the process parameter and always do it. So when it comes to sidestep, you need to keep one thing in mind. The most important thing is, what is my beam diameter? Because as you're printing one layer, the other layer, so there is minimum overlap of 10 or 20 or 15 or 30 microns. There must be an overlap in order for the part to have a good density. In case if you don't have the overlap or improper overlap, so basically what you have is you have a void in between, something like a crack of 30 or 40 microns. So in case of DMP 100 or in 3D system printers, the beam diameter is 60 microns. So in that case, if I want to develop a material, this value doesn't go beyond 120 microns, because 60 plus 60, 120. So if I'm doing 60 and 60, so there is literally no overlap. If I'm going like 130 microns, and there is a gap of 10 microns. So when changing these parameters, we keep the beam diameter in our mind. So this is about the hatch spacing, the first factor here. So the next parameter is, if you see here, there's a laser parameter. So in this, you have the laser thickness. So this is a default material, so we have the material already. And we have different parameters for different things. So the default is the part, actual part. So this is the contour one. So laser power, and this is the laser speed, scan speed. So for contour, my hatch power, laser power is 85 watt, and mark speed is, or these scan speed is 450 mm. If you go for hatching, you have a laser, high laser power. So this is for upper surface. When it comes for middle surface, if you see clearly, your laser power has increased and your mark speed has increased as well. And this is for down facing. In this case, mark speed has increased, but the laser power has decreased. So you need to keep in mind what should be the optimum parameter for down facing surface, for middle surface and the up surface. Because down facing surface, you have supports. So in case if you're printing it with high laser power, then you'll form a rough surface or you'll form dross formation. It will sag. So that is the reason why they are doing it at low power and high speed. When it comes to middle facing, middle area, which is most of the part or most of the printing, where the actual parameters comes into play. So you have high speed as well as high power. And up surface, you have low speed, but a medium laser power. The reason why you have a lower speed and a medium or a middle laser power is because your surface finish should be proper. Inside, you're only worried about the density, or you shouldn't have any porosity or cracks. But when it comes to the upper surface, the finishing surface, it has to have a good surface finish, or it has to have minimum RA value so that you avoid machining most of the part. So that is the reason why they have three different parameters for three different layers. And this is for lattice. So for lattice, you have a different parameter. So for supports, you have a different parameter. So normally supports are porous in nature because they don't want to spend too much of time. So that's why if you see the scan speed of the supports, it's more than what you have seen. It's double than what you have seen for the part. So for part, the maximum is 1000. For support, it's like 2200. So the reason why they have high power and high laser speed is in order to minimize the amount of time that goes into support. Because support is, even if support is not 100% dense, I'm not worried about it because it's a waste. So that's the reason why you have different supports, or for wall support, you have a different. In case if you have some text name of a person or a university, whatever text, so it has a different parameters. So again, it will always change with laser power, laser layer thickness. So in this case, if you see earlier for 30 microns, the laser power was 215 something, but in this case, it is 300. Same as this, earlier it was something like 75. Now it is 100. So it is always dependent on the layer thickness, the scan speed, and the other things. So these four parameters. Yes, sir.
Do you have dual laser or a single laser only?
This is single laser only, but we can also have dual laser.
In that case, we can change the power for two lasers in the individual separate power, or it will be same.
Yes, you can obviously change for both the lasers.
Different power for different lasers we can put?
Yes. Yes, you can have different power for different lasers. But that is for a specific application. I don't know for what application.
Okay.
But our goal is to have a complete dense part without defects.
Okay.
So if you have different
DMP350 has got single laser or dual laser it has got?
No, DMP350 is a single laser machine. DMP 500 is a multi laser machine.
Thank you.
Mr. Lokesh, so you have only 10 minutes. 10 minutes to complete.
Okay. Yes, sir. Almost done.
Okay.
So these are the parameters that you can change always, because this is especially mainly useful for institutes and R&D centers, where you want to develop new materials or where you want to have a different, because as probably you are aware that the materials available for 3D printing are very minimum. So there's it's a very narrow range of material database that 3D printing has. So in case if you want to develop a new material, say a different grade of titanium or a different grade of aluminium, or in case if you want to work with pure copper, made of copper, because these are the most challenging material to work on, like copper and aluminium. So for as of now, we just have one or two material of aluminium that is available in the market. But what about the basic 6000 series of aluminium that you know, that satisfies more, almost most of the applications in automobile? So if I want to develop that material, so this is something that is really very useful. And this tab that you see is exactly the same tab that 3D system uses to develop its own material, to develop its own process parameter for different materials. So this is almost like 95% of what 3D system exactly uses. So that is the advantage of having this software for institutes and R&D centers. Then again, always you can add multiple parts. So you can add copies in the tray. So something like this, or also you have an option for 2D nesting, where what it basically does is I give minimum between two parts, I allow Z rotation and I calculate. So here my target is not set, it's maximum. I can always set the target like something like 50 or something like that. But if you go for maximum, then you start calculating. So it will calculate with minimum two distance between each part, the maximum part that you can place on a tray. So this is for mass production of a single component. So now I can print like 94 of these parts to at one go. So this is the other option that you have for production. And this was the last topic that I wanted to cover. And thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Lokesh. So actually, yes. Actually, as we know that this program, we have planned in a hands-on mode previously. Yes. During the month of March. Then during that time, as we know that we have planned three lab sessions, but
yes,
but you have covered everything in a single slot, which I have given to you. So you have used excellently the time management. You have done very good. So and then like, yeah, and then like it is almost like a thali for the PhD scholars. Actually, I have been asked several questions right from the first my lecture, saying that, sir, can we go for lattice structures or lattice surfaces or the topologically optimized things? I used to get our conformal cooling channels, or how do you develop own material, my own material? So how do you tackle the support generation and how do you fix the orientation? So I used to get a lot of questions, and then I used to clarify them. But okay. you have showed practically, in fact, virtually means in the software. So I am very thankful to you, Mr. Lokesh. Why? Because
welcome.
Yeah, you have given us a full thali of actually as you know that the 3D systems, this 3D expert, I believe that it is a well versed software, but I came to know that still I have to learn. No, there are several features or the options so that the 3D expert is having. I thought in my mind only this much, but still I have to explore, or still I have to spend a lot of time to learn, several features. So which the 3D expert is having. So then, okay, Mr. Lokesh, thank you for your nice demo. So yeah, I think we can run the quiz paper that is in the chat box. Narayana, can you run the quiz paper?
Just now I posted the quiz questions in chat box, sir.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. So can I ask a question?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Okay. Sir, can we do a simulation part of SLM in the software? Animation type of thing?
Yes, sir. You can use any machine, because this 3D expert is compatible with SLM machine. So if you see here, so these are SLM machines. So these are really short. Yes.
Like in the software of Cura, we have a little bit of animation of extruder. So in this case, can we have animation of roller on the powder, something like that?
No, sir. Of now, we don't have any animation of such sort. No, sir.
Hello.
We don't have such an. Yeah,
hello?
We don't have such an animation here.
Sir, I wanted to ask.
Yes.
Sir, I wanted to ask that. I want to have more information about conformal cooling channel, lattice and material, like new material, creating material. So how can I get your guidance or information for the information?
Sir, in case what I'll do is, in the chat box I'll add my email ID.
Okay, sir.
So, you can always contact me for inquiries on Metal AM or the software.
Sir, sir, Lokesh, sir, one more thing. In the that hatch patterns, do we have the chessboard thing? Actually. Only line patterns are we have.
Yes, I'll show you that. I guess I forgot to show you that. So in this hatch part, so for strips, so this is kind of chessboard thing. So you have an horizontal, you have a vertical hatch direction, or a horizontal, or alternate thing like a chessboard.
Alternate.
And a board.
Yes, sir. Okay. Both.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I wanted to ask about conformal cooling channels.
Yes.
So.
Yes, sir.
Sir, can we fabricate the micro channel for MEMS devices? Micro channel in conformal cooling section.
Micro channels for?
For MEMS devices, for electronics application, micro channels.
It depends on the thickness of the channel, like the density, the diameter, or the thickness of the channel, sir.
Sir, the 200, 300 micron range, the channel.
200, 300. It's a bit difficult. Yes. To print, sir, actually.
Okay.
Because it will fuse together. Probably 500, anything more than 500 micron forms might be possible.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hello, sir. Audible? Yes, sir.
Sir, do you provide any training or skill-based training for students in any part of the country?
As of now, we haven't done it. We just do it for our partners.
Okay.
I'll discuss it with my manager and I'll let you know, sir. So in case if you have some...
I'll contact you, sir.
Yes, I've shared my email ID. So you can please give me any query you have.
Any internship?
So internship we don't provide actually, because we are mainly into selling printers, 3D printers.